chance, although family and toilets, there was not the chance to speak. Style risk will shine my Ani toale bit da echlevi chans u ime dos chaos šumih mit tome skudam dole pak mardo nervuti čenu šver am borot kalas am kalas I tres me bobet gledi am kalas I vedni je reba okres am kalas I šver u brodu I tome
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of Reimagining Soviet Georgia. My name is Brian Gigantino. How the Soviet Union came to an end in 1991, after its nearly 70-year existence, is a process and event still mired in controversy and debate. Historians, politicians, citizens of the post-Soviet world, and beyond understand this epochal event in drastically different ways. Was it the result of internal contradictions of the Soviet system? Did pressure from the capitalist world force the USSR into an arms race that led to economic ruin? Was the Soviet Union consciously dismembered by elites from national republics? Did Gorbachev undermine his own political goals? Or was the rise of Boris Yeltsin to blame for the failures of perestroika and glasnost? Did the West, and principally the United States, actively push the USSR towards collapse or earnestly try to save it at the last moment, or both? And what does all of this mean for post-Soviet Georgia? Former First Secretary of the Georgian Communist Party, Edward Shevardnadze, was at the center of it all as the final foreign minister of the USSR, only to return to Georgia and become the president of the country in 1995. His unique role in the process of the USSR's collapse, along with the close connections in the West he made along the way, directly influenced the trajectory of nation building in post-Soviet Georgia. On today's episode, myself, Sopo Japaridze, and Becca Natsvilishvili discuss all of this and more with historian Vladislav Zubok, author of the new book, Collapse, The End of the Soviet Union. Vladislav Zubok, thank you for coming on to Reimagining Soviet Georgia. Why don't you introduce yourself? Who are you and what do you do?
I'm a historian. I was born in Moscow in 1958. Khrushchev was still in power, believe it or not. Then after the collapse of the Soviet Union, I was invited to do historical research in the United States, which I did. Until 2012, and then I got an offer from the London School of Economics, where I teach ever since. I write books mostly on the Cold War, the Russian intellectuals, Russian-Soviet intellectuals, and write articles on post-Soviet developments in international affairs.
Vladislav, you wrote this great new book called Collapse, about the end of the Soviet Union. So just for our audience, you know, what is your book about? Could you just give us a little description? What is the basic idea of your book, Collapse?
Well, the title describes it all. You know, I could have called it demolition. I could have called it implosion. I could have called it many other ways. I chose the word collapse because my idea was... Listen, you know, the Soviet Union must have been an empire and ruled from Moscow, multinational, multi-ethnic, and very complex state with 15 republics, many autonomies, as, you know, people still remember. But, you know, you can say that this sort of multi-level empire, let's call it empire, was doomed under conditions of liberalization, democracy, market, whatever. But the way it disappeared was not inevitable. That was pretty unique. And you cannot find a case in world history when in peacetime, a huge country with a 4 million strong army, with a very potent KGB and other police force, riot police and all that, went up in smoke and peacefully, relatively peacefully, not certainly not in South Caucasus, became a history. So that's was my idea to write about the uniqueness of this process. And what pushed me to write this book is that I teach my students and use, of course, everything that was written before. And when I wrote myself what was written before about the Soviet collapse, I was not satisfied at all. I just thought maybe I should try myself to explain to the younger readers and to my students and to myself why and how it was possible that such a huge country, very authoritarian, began to change so rapidly under Gorbachev, began to liberalize, and then immediately disappeared. What was it inevitable? What or not? In the course of my research, I sort of kept arguing back and forth, and the pressure of the existing literature, the dominant discourse, I should say, on me as a researcher, as an author, was enormous, because everyone told me, including my friends, you know, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? And it's such a decided story. Everything is clear. It was an evil empire, and it was just pushed from abroad. Reagan told it to disappear, right? You know, all the nationalities wanted freedom. Intelligentsia wanted freedom. Oh, what are you talking about? It's a very overdetermined process. So when I began to work with the material, however, the material told me many stories, but very different stories from this kind of deterministic, doomed empire. It told me, first, you know, the Gorbachev tried to change it very radically, unsuccessfully, but very radically. So by 1990, we're not talking about the evil empire anymore. Even Reagan said it, right? It was sort of, you know, a belated but very genuine attempt to create a federation of voluntarily bounded, you know, republics, nationalities, ethnic groups. Bounded by what, you may ask? Yes. And I kept asking myself, what could have bound them together? What could have kept them together? Well, economy to begin with, because everything was really, really interdependent. Uniqueness of history. I'm not going into this too much, you know, so that I wouldn't sound like Vladimir Putin here, but uniqueness in the sense that, you know, it's incredible interlocking ties and relationship. I'm not denying hatreds as well, animosities, tensions, they were always there. But we should not discount the fact that those, you know, countries, as one historian and my friend told me, you know, existed in a sort of a communal apartment, communalka. And, you know, communalka is not the best way to coexist, but sort of people may quarrel in communalka and fight and destroy each other's life and, you know, whatever comfort they have. Or they may develop a community. So I guess Gorbachev, naively or so, began to hope that that community, instead of a former communalka, might be better for most of people. And gradually it would develop in a sort of, you know, a normal voluntary confederation. It didn't work out this way, but I found a lot of evidence how it was actually. You know, the Soviet Union was a tenacious subject. It refused to go away, and not simply because it was maintained by force, not only because they were all these ugly generals and KGB keeping it together. There were a lot of stuff that kept it together. To my surprise, I found even into the last months of 1991, after the August coup in Moscow, which destroyed, you know, the KGB for all purposes, and the arm, demoralized the army. Even after that, there was most of people sort of lived on as if the Soviet Union might sort of continue and roll on and on and on. So it required a lot of political will, efforts, and some external, internal coalitions to tear it apart, literally tear it apart. Sometimes I felt like, you know, politicians tried to tear it apart, while sometimes people, not always, I'm not talking about Georgia, I'm not talking about Azerbaijan from some point on, the Baltics certainly wanted to go, but most of the other people just wanted to continue their life and keep the country.
It's really interesting you mentioned community, because you have a quote from Andropov, which is saying about the Eastern Bloc, this is not a community, this is vulgar robbery.
But this is how economy was important. Yeah, sorry, continue.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, and so, which is interesting, because this is where, you know, nationalism is a funny thing, the way these different nationalities understand now Soviet Union is like Russian nationalists look at it this way. It's like, this is, these small nations were plundering the Soviet Union.
Right.
While Georgian nationalists will say that Georgia was giving way more than it was receiving. Of course, the facts are not on this side. Mm. But this is an interesting how a lot of, well, I think also, like, you, I haven't read the whole book. I read parts of it, and actually we're going to have a study group over it. But it's interesting. You start with Andropov. You start with 1983 as your sort of build up to the collapse. And maybe you can discuss what happened in 1983. Where does all this, like, this, I think also, like, fatalism comes from. There's some, you know, huge problems, and we have to start fixing them right away.
We started already with a similar question, just to deepen this question. What do you mean? Was the Soviet Union an empire in classical understanding, like, you know, empire with the colonies and so on, because it is related with the nationalism and national question generally?
No, well, I don't think the Soviet Union was a typical empire with colonies. Of course, many intellectuals and nationalists, particularly in the Baltic states and gradually during the 70s, if not earlier, in other republics, who remembered periods of independence after the collapse of the, you know, the Russian Empire in 1917, those people, of course, thought differently. They used the language of decolonization and began to conceive of their republics as colonies. But if we look at how the empire functioned, again, we can call it empire, but it was based on radically different principles. Those principles were diverted, particularly under Stalin and later, but those principles were paradoxically, I'm trying to explain it to my students and they're perplexed. It was an idea to create an anti-empire, right, by the Bolsheviks. And Lenin said, listen, there's Ukraine, let's recognize it. Vladimir Putin now takes issue with this, as we know. Accuses Lenin of creating Ukraine. Of course, it's ridiculous, but Lenin at least recognized it against many Russian nationalists who did not want, right? It was recognized that Russian nationalism was the primary danger for the Soviet Union because it is imperialist. Therefore, we must promote non-Russian nationalities. I'm not going into this literature. There's a really interesting literature about it. Yes, those principles, again, were corroded. They were warped later on, but they never fully went away. So, and that's interesting that when Gorbachev, at the end of 1988, with his group of reformers, began to think how I should change the constitution of the Soviet Union, he was bounded by the Leninist principles. And all the more because he was a dedicated Leninist himself in some ways, strange ways, he thought, well, you know, we must go back to Lenin. We must, you know, base all our policies towards non-Russian nationalities, minorities, and so on and so forth, on Leninist principles. And the way he understood it was to give them more autonomy. But while he thought for some reason that it would be possible to keep them all under one tent, of course, and at the moment he began to discuss those constitutional changes, Nagorno-Karabakh exploded, of course, and then of course, Georgia began to say, wait a minute, are you going to recognize us, Abkhazia, as a more autonomous, even threatening the territorial integrity of the Georgian Soviet Socialist Republic, right? So we're against it. So that opened the Pandora box, really, you know, everything began to happen. You know, Estonia declared that they wanted to go back to the old Estonia. And first, what they said in Estonia is interesting. First, yes, we agree. Leninist principles of complete and full sovereignty for Estonia. So let's do it. And we have a full sovereign right to become independent. So later, Estonians, I talked to them recently, they interviewed me. They wanted me to admit that they were the first to kill the Soviet Union. I said, there are many aspirants to this role. There's a whole line behind you. You know, they all wanted to claim they killed the Soviet Union. So don't be in a hurry.
I think that's actually one of the, I guess, funny in the sense that everyone, like, you know, Georgian nationalists also believe that they have gotten freedom themselves, which I find, you know, also, you know, funny, because no one would have gotten anything freedom if it wasn't like from the center, if Moscow did not stop one day, you know. So this mythology of independence that there was one, actually we have two of those mythologies twice. So within 100 years we have two mythologies of us gaining independence on our own. What is it, like, you discussed, and I think this is actually really important, the mainstream narrative is that there was internal contradiction that destroyed the Soviet Union, right? This, like, thing where about, like, how, you know, planned economy never would work, right? This is the narrative. How the corruption was too much, and so on. And so you write this book, even though all your friends are telling you, why waste your time? That actually didn't have to stop. So you could have gone on. And this also thought occurred to me years ago when I see so many horrible places still existing after, you know, for a very long time that have tons of internal contradictions, but they don't end, right? So, like, there must be some kind of flawed logic of saying, like, there's an internal contradiction within capitalism, but capitalism has still not ended, right? So why did you decide to take this endeavor? Like, what is your sort of motive to try to find out, sort of investigate the true story behind it, or at least a story behind the collapse? That would be interesting for a lot of people who listen and are also maybe thinking about how to approach the Soviet Union.
I found the previous explanations inadequate. Since I taught my class on the Soviet history, right, through Stalin, Khrushchev, Brezhnev, Gorbachev, and all of a sudden the Soviet Union ceased to exist, I had to explain to my students what it was about. And the dominant literature basically says the country fell under the weight of so many contradictions, so many pre-existing conditions, primarily a non-market economy, unworkable, the weight of the military-industrial complex, multinational state, we know all empires fall, plus, you know, Chernobyl, Reagan, what else was there? Oh, the Soviets sold oil and depended on oil, and prices, went down in 86. So you can kind of combine all this and they think, you know, there's nothing to write about. And yet we see amazing resilience in all kinds of cases of empires that, you know, by all accounts have to go, and they still sort of continue to exist despite economic inefficiency, despite exploitation of, you know, minorities, despite, you know, all kinds of evil, and so on and so forth. They simply, you know, they don't care. They exist. So for me, it was important to also to deal with nationalist myths. I mean, there were the myths of nationalists who, you said, declared, you know, we killed the Soviet Union. The first came the Poles. We did it. Then the Baltic Bolts. We did it. You know, Georgians maybe as well, and so on and so forth. And finally, of course, Yeltsin with his guys, it's all forgotten now, but when they won, they said, we destroyed the empire, we slayed the dragon of the worst totalitarian empire in the history of mankind. They proudly declared it. They went to Washington, Yeltsin, Burbulis, his right-hand man, Kozyrev, his foreign minister, and others, and basically said, we did it. Here is Russia for you on a silver plate. Accept us to NATO. Accept us into the West. Give us some money. We'll be good, nice, you know, white, fluffy, and peaceful. Okay. That was an amazing moment. And, you know, since, you know, we knew that things developed in a very different way, I wanted to explore how really things happened. What did they really talk about at the time? How did this amazing discourse, for instance, of Yeltsin, you know, we destroyed the totalitarian empire and here we are, please accept us to NATO. How did this develop? At what time? Because it didn't exist even in 1990. It wasn't simply there. So I decided to write the book not about faulty structures, like, you know, sort of like a book of a poorly constructed house. Let's call it an architecture of the Soviet Union. It was a pretty badly constructed house. Nobody would deny. I decided to write the book about the process. So when people criticize me, oh, it's nothing profound, it's blow by blow history. Exactly, this is what I wanted to do, blow by blow, because people's mind changed radically and amazingly during the period of months, sometimes weeks, days. So those things that had been viewed as norms of life suddenly became totally abnormal in the minds of many people, as I write in, you know, the earlier chapters. And including everything, for instance, the Democrats in Russia began to say, we're all victims of the military complex. These generals, this, you know, privileged labs who produce all these nuclear weapons, chemical, biological weapons, all these countless tanks and artillery, they ruined the country. Well, sure enough, of course, it sounds very, very illogical. You go to this military industrial complex documents, suddenly you realize until the spring of 1990, they were kept completely in secrecy, not allowed to meet any foreigners. All of a sudden, in April, May 1990, Gorbachev gave him a green sign. Go, find foreign investors. Basically, we don't have money for you. Survive on your own as much as you want. A crazy story. Of course, they couldn't. They had to learn their ways. They were robbed. They, you know, all kinds of strange characters, American and Swiss and others appeared, tried to rob them, and, you know, take them for the ride. So you find even the military industrial complex when you look inside and use sources, it's not the same. A simple, simplistic, iconic story that, for instance, Democrats tried to sell at the time to the public, and the public accepted the story at the time. It's much more complex and interesting, at least for me. You know, I know some people that they regret when their sort of truth is being destroyed by historical evidence. They hate it. But I enjoy it myself. I really, really enjoy it. I'm open-minded guy. I try to go with the flow and accept the evidence, even most contradictory evidence that comes my way.
Thank you very much. Can you explain, I'm interested exactly in your opinion, Was there a real necessity to reform Soviet Union, of the your point of view? And this is one question, because at the end of the Soviet Union, everybody was talking about the hard economic situation and low growth and this dependence from oil income and so on, and high debt. But if we see the figure, if we look at the figure on statistics, we recognize that not everything was in so bad condition, because there was a still growth, because the economy was already quite big to grow very fast. And it is normal that big economies does not grow very fast. The second, there was something like, you know, everybody is talking about the deficit in grain, deficit and meat and so on. If we see the figure from 1990, we see that meat production was increasing, grain production was increasing, and there was no real not necessity, but there was not real condition for collapse of such quite strong empire. And what do you mean? What was there real necessity to reform it? Because we remember the attempt of reforms, for example, in time of Kosygin after Khrushchev, or during Khrushchev's time. We can also remember about, for example, very interesting idea, what I support generally, OGAS. You know, this scientific information network should enable for better planning and so on. But was there really the necessity to reform it? And what was the real reason for this necessity?
Well, of course, there was a strong reason to reform. And, you know, for those who didn't live in the Soviet Union, it's worth reminding that it was a highly centralized economy based on non-market principles, based on decisions taken by, you know, the relatively few experts and planners. You know, everyone changes, of course. It's impossible to stay the same for more than a few years. So, but let's say in other countries, let's talk about democratic market capitalist countries for briefly, they change because consumers demand change and you know, market adapts. You know, some problems emerge, and let's say Congress passes new laws and legislation. The same was in the Soviet Union. Unfortunately, the system was such that everything depended on the will of one man. And everyone understood it since Stalin times that the time for free debates inside the party was over. They were possible before Stalin took the reins in the 20s. And Gorbachev was fascinated to read all those discussions among Bolsheviks. He, you know, embellished, you know, the party democracy too much. But those debates existed. And of course, the debates about economic reforms in the 60s were allowed by Khrushchev, because, you know, economists convinced him that things need to change. And he knew it himself. The moment he seized power after Stalin's death, he began to all kinds of attempts to change the Soviet economy. You know, Sovnarkhoz, you know, back and forth, dividing the party into agricultural and so on and so forth. Why was that? Because economists kept telling him, you know, there's a lot of problems. We cannot report it publicly, but lots of problems with efficiency, effectiveness, and in the economy. So let me give you one interesting thing that is not in the book. Actually, I received it from a friend of mine, a copy of a special report to Brezhnev from Yuri Andropov, who was just appointed as the head of the KGB. I will tell later tell you the date, so because it's so important and interesting. And there's a long thing basically telling, listen, we achieved a lot, blah blah blah, but we know we have huge problems. We're lagging behind America and Western Europe in terms of electronics and general scientific technical ways. We cannot resolve the problems of agriculture. We cannot resolve this and that. So we have to create special commissions now and take decisions that will affect our future 20, 25 years later, because otherwise, if we don't do it, we'll pay dearly for that. That's Andropov for you, right? Because I begin with Andropov. The document had only few remarks by Brezhnev, presumably. It was found in a desk of Brezhnev's office table, in Brezhnev's office after Brezhnev's death. So Brezhnev read it and did nothing on this, right? He preferred to do détente with the West. He preferred to sell oil and so on and so forth. So the date is interesting. The date was July 6, 1968. A few weeks later, the Soviet Union invaded Czechoslovakia. Basta with reforms, no more reforms. So everyone was quietly, put out, in a drawer and forgotten. That means for 15 or so years, there were no structural changes in Soviet economy, that were thought through, linked to some kind of strategy. And that was an idea that as soon as Brezhnev died, as soon as Andropov became the leader of the country, the first two men he met with, and it's all in his journal, is his diary of his meetings. There's nothing, unfortunately, on the content, but just the names. I met such and such. There are two people, Dolgih and Ryzhkov. On what? Economic reforms. He met with them more than anyone else during a few months that he was still healthy and he could function. Later he got sick and died. So Ryzhkov became, as we know, the head of Gorbachev's Council of Ministers and resigned only because of heart attack at the end of 1990, right? So this is very significant, I think, because immediately, as soon as Andropov took power, he returned to that document that he wrote back in 1968. But he lacked his personal time. He was sick, he was doomed, he died and passed away. This is why when my critics tell me Andropov was not a reformer, he was a KGB thug, he tortured people, he put people in psychiatric hospitals, dissidents, Sakharov, blah, blah, blah. Gamsakhurdi, Gamsakhurdi and so on. I said, true. True. And who told you that a KGB authoritarian guy cannot be a reformer? I've just read a book about Cuba. Fulgencio Batista, who was overthrown by Castro, he did reforms because it was necessary. People demanded it. He did reforms. At the same time, he was a corrupt bastard, Batista. And this is why he was overthrown by his people later on.
Did the people demand reforms? Because there was some way of identification of people's will or something like that, or channels through which the people could channel their demand. Because you mentioned just 2 minutes ago that the people demanded the reforms.
Yes, not in Cuba. People in Cuba demanded reforms. People in the Soviet Union were taught not to demand anything, of course, particularly towards the end of Brezhnev's rule. It was, however, I repeat, it was a society that was based on dynamic ideology, on the idea of changing society, reforming society. So it was absolutely clear by the end of the 70s that no one believes in socialism. Well, maybe some people I met a young poet in Dagestan who said, Lenin is my hero. That was in 1988. I said, oh my goodness, finally I met someone for whom Lenin is a hero. No one in Moscow thought that Lenin was a hero at that time. So people lost trust. People lost dynamism. Nobody asked them. There was participation in anything approaching like discussion was in the 60s, before 68, when people were deliberately urged and asked by main newspapers, you know, send us your proposals, participate in this discussion as sort of like not a referendum, but a way of participatory thing. So when Andropov returned, he didn't ask anyone. They didn't ask people. He didn't even ask elites. He just appointed a secret committee headed by Ryzhkov and began to plan reforms. And Gorbachev initially did the same until 1989, you may say. No, wait a minute, let me take it back. In 88 was probably a better date because there was this party conference in, I think, July 1988, when Gorbachev addressed the party elites and sort of asked them what kind of changes do you want. But he himself mistrusted those elites. He did not think that they would represent the true interests of the people. So he continued to operate within very narrow circle of reformers, meeting in secrecy, basically. No one was brought in, no media coverage was there, no glasnost was there. So when I asked Shevardnadze in 1999 about it, he kind of said very interesting thing. He said Gorbachev used Stalin's power to dismantle Stalinist state. The emphasis is on he used Stalin's power. I would add even Stalin's methods, because, you know, everything was closed, you know, not discussed. So that was the first round of reforms of 87, 88. But then things changed dramatically because, of course, in 89, Gorbachev changed the whole constitutional setup, changed the political system of the Soviet Union, and everything began to be discussed by people's deputies openly in front of TV cameras for the whole country. So that was, you know, amazing and an immediate change of political regime.
One of the themes of your book that I really enjoyed was the dynamic between the Soviet elites and the West, and in particular the U.S., especially because, you know, I think that very often the role of the United States and the U.S.-Soviet relationship towards the end of the USSR is totally mired in, you know, misunderstandings, mythologies. And in particular, if we think about the connection to Georgia, you know, there's a statue of Ronald Reagan in the center of Tbilisi, which is claimed as
being didn't see it. Okay.
Oh yeah, in Enrique Park, and you have this, you know, you have this narrative that, you know, Ronald Reagan was responsible for the dismantlement of the Soviet Union, and therefore the United States saved Georgia, and this is the basis of their, you know, common anti-Soviet orientation. What I wanted to bring up was that in your book, you know, you go into the deep nuance of this dynamic with Bush, for example, Bush 1, George H. Walker Bush, and how the Soviet elites at the end are navigating what seemed to be a sort of a contradictory position from the Americans. On one hand, needing or desiring to sort of save the USSR because they're nervous about what could happen if it collapses, but at the same time trying to push and demand for concessions or political concessions that seem to be striking at almost the core of the state's legitimacy or the essence of the state's legitimacy towards the end. And so I'm wondering if you could just, you know, help our audience understand, you know, how would you describe the relationship of the USSR and the United States at the end of the Soviet Union? And what role did the United States play or not play in its eventual dismemberment?
Well, it's a huge question. I know, I'm afraid I cannot answer, you know, this in 5, 10 or half an hour or 1 hour. with nuance. But what surprised me most, although at the time I was at the US and Canada Institute in Moscow and met many Americans, even at the time as a young man. So at the time, it was simply looked natural to me that we must become partners with the United States. As a young man, I didn't ask myself, what does it mean to be partners with Americans? What does it entail? I simply believed it. And by the way, I was surprised to find even in Brezhnev's minutes in the late 60s, when the detente was starting, Brezhnev scribbled down, he had terrible, very strange way of writing in Russian with many mistakes. But he wrote, it would be nice to have Americans as our partners, even Brezhnev. But what I found, of course, is the speed with which the Soviet Union began to weaken and later split into different parts surprised Americans a lot. They were not ready. Only ideologues like Reagan were sort of, freedom wins, that's great. But all in the CIA, in State Department, all professionals who learned about Russia, the Soviet Union, all their lives, it took them by surprise. And moreover, they found Gorbachev's behavior very strange. My typical sort of example is Bush's friend, National Security Advisor Brent Scowcroft, who was a military. He took classes at West Point. He studied Russian history. He learned one thing about Russia, the pre-Soviet Russia even, that it is an autocratic empire that basically is huge. Has to protect its borders, must have a huge army, and is sort of by definition it has to be autocratic, militarized, and that's it. That's a normal condition for Russia. Okay, and so all of a sudden he sees Gorbachev trying to dismantle it very rapidly, very idealistically, and he's, oh my God, what should we do? It's almost like, slow, Mikhail. He wants him to slow down. But the things, and then the Bush and Scowcroft and others, Gates, the CIA, they realize, the train is not slowing down. The train gets accelerated all the time. So what should we do? And what's clear that they never came up with any strategy. I found some interesting ideas when they were guided by the Cold War mentality through and through until the very end of the Soviet Union. They were creatures of the Cold War, all of them. All their career went during the Cold War. So I wasn't surprised when I found Bush's friend, tennis partner, Secretary of Treasury Nicholas Brady saying, let them move to market. They won't be able to afford the big military-industrial complex and the big army. They will become a third-rate power, and this is what we here want. So this was a typical Cold War kind of strategy that America pursued towards the Soviet Union since 1948. And on. So there's nothing surprising here. What was surprising when, Bush, when he realized that Mikhail was kind of a rope walker with so many dangers, the Bolts wanted to secede, the Georgia secedes, Armenia, Azerbaijan, everything. And then he's like a rope walker. And suddenly Bush decides we should hold him. Let him walk for a while, longer, because, he gave us so much. He helped us to reunify Germany in NATO. He let Eastern Europe go and Berlin Wall down. you know, he's trying to democratize and liberalize this hugely different country, again, almost against the grain of the entire history of this country. Let us do anything to help him stabilize and walk on this rope. So that was until the very coup. The August of 1991, and many people later criticized Bush for this famous Chicken Kiev speech by William Sapphire comes to mind. But I think Bush and Scowcroft were absolutely right in doing what they did. When they realized all power passed to Yeltsin and the Russian Federation, even then they tried to kind of balance between Yeltsin and Gorbachev. And interestingly enough, people today, some people say in Twitter, you know, why Russia became a successor to the Soviet Union? Why Russia has this permanent seat in the United Nations? Very simple, because the United States and UK and other permanent members of the UN pushed Russia to take this seat. And there's a one remarkable episode after the coup at the end of August 1991, when Shevardnadze, who resigned from the post of foreign ministry, sits in Moscow. And there's a whole delegation from the foreign ministry coming to him. And Lavrov is one of them. And Lavrov says, listen, you know, Eduard Amrosich, please come back. You need to become the minister. You're respected by the whole world, because if you don't return, they will take our permanent seat in the United Nations from us and we'll cease to be a great power. And of course, you know, the surprise was they never even tried. On the contrary, they wanted Russia to become, you know, successor to the Soviet Union, take responsibility for all Soviet debts, for all nuclear weapons, and all the responsibilities and commitments and treaties and obligations that the Soviet Union concluded, many thousands of them during the existence of the Soviet Union. So, interesting.
What's the point? Like, what does it mean to be a reformer in the Soviet Union if you don't believe in socialism? Like, I'm trying to wrap my head around this, and it's so confusing to me. Like, why would you even care to reform if you don't believe in this project, right? Like, what's driving it then? Like, what is the drive for Andropov, you know, even Brezhnev? Well, he didn't try to reform, but still, what is the Gorbachev? Like, how can you be a Leninist and do Pizza Hut commercials? Like, that doesn't make any sense to me, right? That makes zero sense.
Don't telescope it, you know. Gorbachev selling pizza is after Gorbachev was in power and did reforms. There are two phases in Gorbachev's life. We shouldn't like lump them together at all. I think returning back to the question about why reforms, that's a key question. I think they, both Andropov and Gorbachev, started reforms because they believed in socialism. Because they believed in socialism. And they were convinced, wrongly or whatever, that the system had potential. And this potential was denied to it by years of stagnation, mismanagement, Stalinism, whatever. You know, there are many, many, many culprits of why socialism did not flower. Okay. And but the most important thing for us is because they were the believers and not cynical careerists and bureaucrats, this is why they launched reforms. This is why. Brezhnev, I guess, he didn't care much about ideology. He came to power in certain circumstances. He, when Andropov kind of tried to push him, listen, you know, socialism, we need to be on the forefront of socialist technical revolution. You know, we are in competition with capitalism. And for Brezhnev, it was not so important. He just walked into power. He understood power as something as daily chore. He had to pick the phone and talk to all the people, sort of like a normal democracy, a head of the political machine was do every morning, would call all people who depended on him and say, hello, good evening, good, how's your family? Everything is great, everything is fine, how I can help you. So this is sort of like Brezhnev, almost like a normal politician. But Andropov and Gorbachev, they didn't do it. They didn't do it. You know, Andropov jailed communists and thieves and crooks and corrupt officials. And Gorbachev preferred to huddle with small group of people and think how to save the socialist project. And this is how it went.
How would you comment these thesis, for example, that for the Soviet Union generally, after Stalin or during Stalin, was oriented on providing of basic need for all, and this was the main goal of the economic and societal system. And after Khrushchev, or after the end of Cold War, not Cold War, but the Second World War, when the people came back from war to their homes and somehow they demanded some consumer goods, and after that there emerged some necessity to be oriented not on basic needs like it was previous time in the Stalin's time or short after Stalin, but we more oriented on consumer goods, like, you know, better TV, better clothing, better, I don't know why. And that's why I think that this emergence of reforms, or the necessity of reforms, how it emerged, it is quite strongly attached to the understanding of goal of Soviet Union as an economy which is oriented on better consumer goods, because it changed somehow from basic needs to consumer goods, like, I don't know, jeans, cola, or better lemonade, or something like that.
Well, I would say yes, absolutely. Except I don't think the war changed much in this. Historians, including myself, they say, yes, millions of people occupied Austria, Germany, Czechoslovakia, and they saw much higher living standards. But, you know, people remembered the NAP, people remembered the 20s and much higher living standards then. The food was plenty. Everyone could, you know, could buy whatever food they wanted. It was time of plenty in the 20s, even under the Soviets. So, yes, I think later on you had what you may call a consumerist revolution. It was uneven. It started in the United States, of course. Then it spread to Western Europe. In Italy, it started in the 60s. The same in the UK. You know, when the Queen died, I watched there lots of interesting footage on television when they buried the Queen. You know, I realized, hey, you know, the British lived quite poorly in the 50s, and to buy a refrigerator, to buy a washing machine was a luxury for many. So only the 60s changed it. So, you know, the Soviet Union was behind, but not drastically behind, right? Because at the end of the 60s, I remember, you know, Georgia was very, very privileged and special, but in sort of poor Russian regions, peasants, collectivized peasants, began to buy TV sets, refrigerators, and other durables. And that was the end of the 60s, early 70s. So yes, 10 years after the UK, but not like catastrophic delay. What I think changed this equation dramatically was that people lost their faith that they built in different kind of society. When they lost this faith, they simply began to say, you know, what's all this crap about socialism? Why is that? You know, we just need material goods. And I think Georgia was leading in this way. You know, I remember I was in Georgia in 1888, and I was struck by abundance you know, and even earlier, of course, the 70s, I was in Abkhazia, and my goodness, these people live so well in Abkhazia, an incredible wealth. And they made it on tourism, of course, they made it on selling tangerines and stuff and fruits and stuff. But, you know, I thought, you know, okay, they're privileged people. Absolutely. And everything was about material, you know, all these slogans there in the streets, communism, blah, blah, blah. Nobody believed the thing. So, and when this happened, of course, and it happened to Eastern European countries, of course, much more radically, much more early. It happened even in Cuba under Castro, let's say, towards the 70s, at some point in the 70s, the Cubans grew tired of constant mobilization and constant campaigns to build socialism. That was a problem. Then you had to face it. And to face it was the only way, you know, you import these things, but you need currency. You produce these things yourself on the home ground. But, you know, why they couldn't do it is a mystery. Why it was so difficult to let Georgian black, you know, gray economy to produce enough jeans, or people in Odessa, let's say, go ahead, make these jeans, put the label, you know, whatever label you want on it, sell it. That was stupidity. But the paradox, again, of socialist reformism is that Gorbachev launched this reforms as a socialist believer. As a believer in Lenin, not like Deng Xiaoping, who in China basically said, you know, go ahead, just sell, you know, and we'll we keep communist elites in power, and we'll become rich and keep the power under the Communist Party. You know, from Deng Xiaoping to Xi Jinping, you know, they chose this way, capitalism. But they call it socialism with Chinese characteristics. Gorbachev genuinely wanted to save, to rescue the socialist project, but as a result, his reforms were non-capitalist and non-market. To the last moment, Gorbachev, when they proposed to him pretty nice schemes in 1990, let's move to market quickly. And by the way, had he moved even in spring 1990 to the market, you know, I have no way to prove it, of course. I don't know. But had he done it, imagine all these protesters in the streets of Tbilisi and Kutaisi and I don't know where, in Baku. You know, they would have just went in the direction of selling things, producing things, making money, doing this. Enormous energy of protest would have transformed into market energy. So instead, Gorbachev kept saying, no, we don't need capitalism. We don't need, you know, people will suffer, will be unemployment, there will be inequality. We don't need this. So it was Gorbachev's stubbornness to refuse this kind of road. I think that contributed remarkably to the demise of the Soviet Union.
When I read the discussion about the collapse of Soviet Union in general from different point of view and from different experts, for example, everybody is talking about when they compare the collapse of Soviet Union and reforms which started during, I don't know, Andropov and carried out from Mikhail Gorbachev. And with Deng Xiaoping. So Deng Xiaoping made one thing. He opened the economy, but maintained the political system. But the Gorbachev did it in vice versa. They opened political system, but he was not brave enough to open the economy in the extent like maybe it would be necessary. I don't know, because it is a question of taste. And do you know about what I remember in this discussion? Because after the collapse of Soviet Union, in each post-Soviet countries, we started with the economic reforms, with a shock therapy and so on, which were very radical. And we thought that not only we, but generally the intellectuals and the scientists, IMF, World Bank, and so on, everybody thought that economic reforms will bring democracy with it. Because it was something like there was, they thought that there are some similarities, like to have the market, it means that you will have the freedom. But it is, sorry, but it's wrong. You know, it's emergency. It was biggest mistake. And that's why, in this sense, what do you mean? Which reform should be carried out from Gorbachev at the first stage?
I would say, of course, for Gorbachev, it would have been more logical to keep the power, political power, and instead of experimenting with multi-party system, with all these unwieldy parliaments where so many people, you know, those of you who remember, they come to a microphone, they spoke each for 30 minutes and the next people just talked, and the economy went down and down and down. So would have been logical to start with a controlled market reforms, all the more so that you had one economy. We call it Soviet economy, but it was in reality one economy. There were no borders between Georgia or the Russian Federation, Georgia or Armenia. It was one economy. I visited some factories in Georgia and asked them, what do you produce? Or such and such. Where do you send it? We send it to Siberia. We send it to the Urals. We send it, you know, all over the country. Same for everyone. So it would have been logical to launch the market reforms and transformation of one giant economy without destroying so many chains of supply, so many existing connections between, you know, yes, inefficient, but still workable units, workable enterprises in this economy, and gradually modernize it as you make money, as you move on. Instead, Gorbachev allowed, you know, political liberalization. With it came separatism and nationalism. And of course, when you have thousands of people in the in marching under the slogans, you know, down with the empire, basically those people don't care that if Georgia pulls out or if Estonia pulls out of this economy, that would be huge economic crisis. Gorbachev never could understand it. He kept telling the Balts naively, you know, you will not survive. Well, they survived, okay, finally, after a huge crisis, but they survived. And of course, Georgia survived with enormous losses and poverty and misery and so on and so forth. But it would have been from economic viewpoint, and actually from the viewpoint of keeping power, if Gorbachev really had been more serious about it, it would have been more logical to allow market reforms and regulate it, having the party there and telling the party officials, you are stakeholders, become stakeholders of this process, you know, follow me into this process. This is exactly what Deng Xiaoping did in China. He had the army behind him. He told those red families, you know, go and trade and participate in capitalism and get rich. But he said, we need to keep it under control and we need to keep everything under, you know. Now, China, of course, now is maybe in its decline, as they say, but only after 30, 40 years of unbelievable growth, unbelievable development that is the envy of the world, right? So definitely Gorbachev lived in another society, and the most of scholars keep piling up differences. They said, no, it would not work because no peasantry. It was a different country. You know, Russians do not work as hard as Chinese and blah, blah, blah. But still, it would have worked in some way, maybe not as greatly as in China. I'm sure not as greatly, but it would have worked much better than it did ultimately in the 90s in all separate republics that took place of one country.
That's actually what I was going to say is Chinese model really rests a lot on dispossession, like not just Chinese. I mean, capitalism in general, you sort of have to have people fighting for survival to work such, you know, long hours. And the Soviet Union workers were so privileged They were like, I mean, their labor standards are unbelievable compared to now. Their privileges, their time off. It would be interesting to see how that would have worked.
Gorbachev stood in the way. Gorbachev clearly stood in the way. Yes, I would say he was timid. He was, as said at some point, it's easy for the Poles to do shock therapy and survive. It will be impossible to do it for us because people will sweep us aside. I'm skeptical. When Gorbachev said it, with the KGB in control, with the army and so on and so forth, and the logic of market, look what happened in Russia. I know Russian history better after 1991. Let's say, after shock therapy, did people rebel? No. The deputies of the Supreme Soviet rebelled and they were crushed by tanks, by Yeltsin in October 1993. Did Ukrainians rebel when they had to introduce, ultimately, with 2 years of delay, shock therapy or sort of like market reforms? No, they didn't rebel. They rebelled later when they began to feel it a little bit better in 2004, the first Maidan. So for me, I think Gorbachev was not really right when he said, oh, we couldn't do it because people would have been like up in the revolution like in 1917. That's rubbish. I don't accept it. I think he just lost. He blew his chance. He lost his opportunity to do it for the whole country. As simple as that.
I agree with you. The only thing I would say is that the shock therapy only worked because they dispossessed people.
Oh, yes. And he was a humanist. The second reason why he didn't want to do it. He said, I'm a country boy. I grew up after collectivization. I saw what collectivization did to, Ukrainians and Russians and other poor people. I don't want to subject my people to another cruel social experiment. This is what he kept saying. And even when he went to London on the eve of the coup in July 1991, and Yavlinsky, young reformer, Yavlinsky kept telling him, this is the plan. Take this plan with you. Ask the Westerners for, $100 billion to back up your plan of market terror. Gorbachev said, I'm afraid speculators will buy all property and make people poor. And he kept saying it. And as a result, it happened, but without him, in a much worse situation under terrible conditions.
I remember about Andropov's quote in your book. He was saying that before the reform, you have to give the people some tangible, and after that you can provide the reform or carry out the reform. Maybe Gorbachev did not enough to give the people something tangible before he started this reform. It's just a small remark from me. But my question is about Yavlinsky, for example. I remember that there was a 500-day plan or 500-day plan through which, frankly speaking, I got some impressions that the 500-day plan was something like to get the independence for Russian Federation. This plan was for getting Russia in the Russian Federation independence, or create something quite loose union from different independent countries. Like, it was not confederation according to this plan. It was like, I would say, even not European Union, it was like economic union or something like that. The same was also, Novogorsk process. Constitutional changes have been discussed. And the Yeltsin's position was the same. He was fighting for more independence of Russian Federation, even for abolishing the Soviet Union. Do you mean that, how do you estimate the Yeltsin's, Yavlinsky's, or mostly Yeltsin's, because he was the most strong figure in this time, in this group. How do you mean, how do you estimate the Yeltsin's role in the destroying of Soviet Union generally? How, what is his stake in this process? And the second question, because Yeltsin and this group somehow fighted for Russian independence, and if we see or read this, you know, this transcript of this Novogor process, where the constitutional changes have been discussed, we see that somehow he tried to distance himself from different republics and other republics, because, for example, Kravchuk is more or less confused which side he should take, and some Asian republics are also some kind in confusion which side they should take of Gorbachev or Yeltsin. But Yeltsin's clear position was that he demanded more power for Russian Federation, even even abolish generally Soviet Union as such or as it existed before. And you know, because Yeltsin's position was this, and the Russian Federation gets the independence after the 1991, after the SNG emerged. Why Russian Federation, for example, interfered in Georgia? Because he tried to build in Georgia, in Nagorno-Karabakh. Okay, Nagorno-Karabakh was a little bit earlier, but for example, Georgia was already independent country, already recognized independent country from Russian Federation. Why this guy, Yeltsin, which fighted for his own independence and distancing from different republics, interfered, for example, in Georgia? What was his interest in this sense? Because it's somehow I got the impression that Yeltsin was not interested to keep this imperia together.
Well, you ask so many interesting questions, and maybe I will write another book, a sequel book, about what happened after December 1991, because essentially the last question, why did the same man as struggled for Russia's independence began to intervene in the post-Soviet space, as it was called? You know, all I can say with the sources and evidence that I saw, that Yeltsin hesitated to admit his role in destruction of the Soviet Union. He always denied it. He, you know, essentially said that the end of the Soviet Union was a result of Gorbachev's failures, the failure of Gorbachev's reforms. It was not his intention to undo. Which is sort of interesting, because I mentioned earlier that at some point he sent Bourbalis to Paris, Brussels, and Kozyrev to Washington with the message, we destroyed the totalitarian empire. So there was a contradiction. And I think why Yeltsin was so hesitant to accept his role, a huge role, I should admit, in the destruction of the Soviet Union, was a simple way, because it was an intuitive politician. He knew that some Russians would applaud him, but more Russians would probably not applaud him for saying it. It wouldn't have been popular. So because he was a politician, he decided not to highlight. But the way it worked is really, really fascinating. And I find at first Yavlinsky came to Yeltsin with his plan that actually was stolen for him by another guy from the Russian parliament, Russian Supreme Soviet. And this plan was called 400 days. And that other guy said, we should just do it as a Russian market reform, and to hell with everyone else. But other republics can do whatever they want. We'll just proceed ourselves separately. And then Yavlinsky came to Yeltsin and patiently explain to him that it's impossible. It's impossible because it's one economy. There's no such thing as Russian economy. There's Soviet economy that spans through all the republics within the boundaries of the Soviet Union. If you try to do it in the Soviet, in the Russian Federation, it would be like trying to treat a patient, that has only body but no arms, no legs, and probably no some parts of the brain as well, because this patient would die. And Yavlinsky's message was: it's impossible to do market reforms within the Russian Federation that has no state of its own, no customs, no system of taxation, nothing. Everything that exists is only Soviet for all the republics. And that was a problem with Baltic separatism as well with Georgian separatism, because in economic laws dictated, or laws or whatever, realities dictated that Georgia could not escape Soviet economic orbit easily. It could, but at the cost of tremendous plunge in its living standards. So I came to Georgia in 1999, talked to peasants, talked to countrymen, they're all like impoverished beyond belief, 9 years after the Soviet collapse. So it was economic consequence of the dismemberment of one economy. And Yeltsin listened, and he seemed to agree with Yavlinsky that it's true, although I don't think he understood the economic logic of it. And he agreed that let's do it together with Gorbachev. And had they done it together, Yeltsin and Gorbachev, had they launched this 500 days or whatever it was called, let's call it just market reform, history of the Soviet Union would have turned out very differently. I'm almost convinced. The energy of the people would have went from political separatism, from these things, to just a matter of redividing property, establishing new economy, making money, and so on and so forth. But Gorbachev did not do it ultimately, and Yeltsin went his way. He returned to this kind of point before Yavlinsky. He began to claim that all assets within the Russian Federation should belong to Russia, period. So, which led, in a sense, the parade of sovereignties, and which made Ukrainians and Kravchuk to do the same. Okay, if Russian oligarchy is forming on the basis of Russian wealth, if Russian nomenclatura, part of nomenclatura, is trying to become rich on the basis of what they own, 75% of all Soviet wealth, all oil, diamonds, and so on and so forth, we in Ukraine want to do the same. And this is what they did. And I think, very briefly, your last question, still to be investigated. I think Yeltsin never could escape the political inertia of Russia being an empire. And he thought, now Russia is independent, but we have to rebuild the empire somehow. Obviously not by claiming these lands back, not fighting for those lands, but let's do it like other former empires do, by reestablishing our economic presence there, our economic interests, and maybe using our military just to have bases here and there. If you looked around in history, this is what British did, this is what French did, this is what Belgian did, even the Americans in Cuba. Again, I mentioned Cuba in Central America, the Philippines. This is what Americans did: economic domination, military bases like Guantanamo in Cuba, and all kinds of other means, financial domination, and corrupting elites, corrupting the military, and all those things. It was not Yeltsin's invention to do this. It was unfortunate for Georgians, but it was kind of, I think, almost natural.
Where do you place Shevardnadze in all of this, in his role, and how the events unfolded?
I should write a separate book about it. Absolutely. There's so much that I couldn't include into my book, and so much that was recorded by Shevardnadze's loyal speechwriter, Teimuraz Mamaladze-Stepanov. And I find those notes and diaries by Teimuraz as probably one of the best sources on the Soviet collapse, next to Chernyayev's diaries, for instance, and a couple of others. One of the best, definitely. So we have this source. Stepanov is almost always next to Edward, to Chernadze, almost always. He sees everything. His duty is to record everything about Chernadze. And what's fascinating about observing Shevardnadze's role. Shevardnadze, of course, is keenly aware that he's a Georgian that is in a key position of responsibility on which depends the future of the Soviet Union. And by the way, he also is aware that the Soviet Union is not just the Soviet Union, it's Russia. So he is a Georgian in among Russians, in the center of the Russian Empire, in the position of extreme responsibility. And he even once said to his two closest assistants, listen, can you imagine what can happen to me if things go wrong? There were already two Georgians in high places in the Soviet Union, of course, Stalin and Beria. Look, Stalin died peacefully. Beria, not so. So I don't want to be the third. So he keeps his eyes on many desks, chess desks simultaneously, Shevardnadze. So he plays the international desk, but he always thinks what is going on in Georgia. And of course, after April 1989, he's in crisis. Is absolutely in crisis because he had to come to talk to people, to students in Tbilisi, to explain why the Russians fired at Georgian people, who made it possible. And for him, it's he begins suddenly to see that he's sitting trying to sit on two chairs simultaneously, because all Georgians keep looking to him as their man in Moscow who basically needs to protect them and, serve their interests. He's the most important Georgian in the world. And he should talk, by the way, to Reagan about them. He should talk to Bush about Georgians, not the Soviet Union, Georgians. And, you know, and that one stool, and another stool is, of course, he is, the foreign minister of the Soviet Union, and he's falling. These stools begin to, to pull apart, and he's falling that. And so his first time that he decided to resign from his position is December 1989, highly emotional moment when what triggered this resignation, it's not at all foreign policy at all. It's not the Berlin Wall. You know, he does feel that Russian nationalists, Russian hardliners begin to use him as a scapegoat. They essentially grumble, look, Shevardnadze makes all these concessions to the West. It's, we used to have Gromyko and we were strong power, and all of a sudden this Georgian is there and we're giving away Eastern Europe, we're giving away Germany. But it's not the major factor why he decided to resign. The main factor was his inability to combine two stools. And when General Rodionov, who used power against Georgian demonstrators in April 1989, testified to the Second Congress of People's Deputies and made some horrific statements, basically they are guilty themselves, the military is not guilty, blah blah blah, and then this was the moment when Shevardnadze just blew off totally. I said, I'm resigning, I don't want to be here. And Gorbachev told him, listen, I need you because you're the second after me whom the West knows and trusts, Americans, trusts you. Germans trust you. We need to go through so many crises together, like German reunification, like, you know, locking in the post Cold War world in Europe, common European house. Eduard, I need you. And he stayed. And he stayed for one more year, and he resigned only, as we all know, very dramatically in on December 21st, 1991, exactly on this day. And at that time, he already knows that maybe Georgia will need him soon, because during Gamsakhurdia days and months, he knows he will never be able to return to Georgia, because Gamsakhurdia basically treated Shevardnadze very, very poorly and kept threatening him. If you don't do this, if you don't, if you're supporter of Abkhazians, you're supporter of whoever, Ossetians, you know, Georgian people hate you and all these things. In December 91, Gamsakhurdia's star falls very quickly, and immediately people sent envoys. I know one of them, by the way, personally, to Eduard, to Moscow, and would you like to return? Maybe. So he already knows when he resigned that he may or may not go back to Tbilisi and start a new career as a Georgian statesman. I found this as an absolutely fascinating case when someone almost immediately sheds his takes off one hat of a Soviet foreign minister and puts another hat off, you know, the father of the young Georgian nation immediately. That's absolutely fascinating.
So the idea of constructing an alternative oil route through Georgia to Turkey, you know, Shevardnadze is the one who came up with that and convinced the Americans to do it. So, you know, the BP pipeline or whatever other names for it. So what you just said, that he takes off one hat, puts on the other one. And this is very confusing, because there's this, all this, at least what I have read on this topic, it's like Shevardnadze is like, you can never trust Russia. You know, we have to protect ourselves away from Russia. So it's really confusing to why would this narrative be around Shevardnadze, who has been, you know, the second person in charge of the entire Soviet Union before, you know? And why is this so much supposed distrust? Or is it against Yeltsin at that point? You know, what exactly is happening? Or maybe the people are just, were writing about this, are just lying, you know? What do you think is happening there?
First thing, geopolitical change, enormous. It's one thing to have the Soviet Union collapsing. And another thing is the Russian Federation becomes recognized as a successor to the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union is over, finished, doesn't exist. And Russia takes its place with other republics becoming fully independent, recognized by international community, but operating in the post-Soviet space with practically one indivisible Soviet economy and one currency, ruble, no more currencies at that time, and in the, what you can say, highly chaotic international environment that classical theorists of international relations would call Hobbesian, you know, when, you know, Hobbes said about the war of everyone against everyone, a very dangerous environment. This is one thing. And the second thing, I'm sorry to disappoint you, but politicians are chameleons. They change color immediately. They, you know, this is why they're politicians. And Shevardnadze did not do it all overnight, of course. He had his period when he was in retirement, and he used massively his political capital. He set up Association of Foreign Policy in Moscow with two of his trusted assistants, nobody else. He traveled to America, he traveled to Germany, he traveled to other countries. Basically, he capitalized on his connections made during the end of the Cold War. And of course, he met Hans-Dietrich Genscher, he met his friend James Baker and other friends. He had enormous connections, valuable connections. So the point when he came to Georgia, you know, basically had no power. You know, others, Iosiliani and others had armed power, not him. But he had international legitimacy. He controlled it. And during the first months after appearing in April, I think it was in April 1992, he came in within just a few months. One man used this enormous international legitimacy capital to have Georgia recognized. Don't forget, nobody wanted to recognize Gamsakhurdia's Georgia. No one. It was basically called a fascist dictatorship, you know, of crazy nationalists. Nobody wanted to deal with it. Shevardnadze changed it within several months. But he realized with this immediate war in Abkhazia, with this problem of Adjaria and other problems, very poor neighborhood, very troublesome neighborhood, he knew it, that you need to put something on the map of the United States of America that would be valuable for Americans. And what was valuable for Americans? Very easy. The map with pipelines. The map with pipelines, to put it very simply. So he decided to change the map of the Caucasus for Americans. Originally, he used other things. He said, oh, Georgia is such a Christian small country, but very pivotal, surrounded by Muslims. Central Asia would go like the way of Afghanistan. It's very dangerous. So he played this. And he could see that Americans were not buying it. And Germans were saying, huh, well, big deal, you know, so it's your problem. You know, you are our man, but, you know, essentially the Caucasus is something that's so far from us. But when you built a pipeline, immediately, and I could see it myself, I was in Washington at that time, I could see myself how the discourse immediately began to change about Georgia and the Caucasus in Washington. Hey, they have oil. They have, you know, the Baku oil comes bypassing Russia. Very important, you know, even before Putin was still not in Moscow. The Americans already began to speak geopolitical language of oil and gas and how to bypass this dangerous, unpredictable Russian bear, Russian, you know, giant. And so, you know, it was already all there.
I'm Kalachi Fles, Mepo Ben Glebi, I'm Kalachi Betni Ereva, Mokres, I'm Kalachi Juen, Ubrad Witrodit Ziskis, Kadakilitziska, Kadakilitziska, Kadakilitziska,